Good afternoon. I'm Jim Hoagland. I'd like to welcome you here to a conversation with George Shultz. I'll start off with some contradictory statements. One is that George Shultz needs no introduction, particularly to this crowd, but I'm going to do it anyway because I enjoy it. It's great to be here talking with a man who has served in four cabinet-level positions. I'm reliably informed that only Elliot Richardson ever did something approaching that. And with all due respect to Mr. Richardson, I don't think he played quite the key crucial roles that George Shultz did as Secretary of Labor, Secretary of Treasury, and Secretary of State, where in my view, and I've read a lot of this history, he played the crucial role in realizing that the end of the Cold War was coming and setting it on that path. He also served as director of OMB, very crucial position as well. He is a lifelong Marine, as he demonstrated yesterday when he stood up to come to the defense of Henry Kissinger and also of his wife, who was there in the audience yesterday at the congressional hearing where a group of protesters started swinging handcuffs that were supposed to be symbolic around but actually could have hurt people.
And you read a lot about Washington when you're out in California. But I thought you testified before the Armed Services Committee. You wouldn't get physical assault.
Times have changed, George.
Times have changed.
Alas. And of course, he is a devout husband of Charlotte, who a force of nature in her own right, and who is here to correct us if we go wrong during this conversation. George, it's just a great pleasure to have you here. I would like to remind everyone to turn off cell phones, and we will go. We will have a short question and answer period at the end of the conversation. This is being webcast and recorded. So, if you would please identify yourself when you ask questions and state any affiliation. George, I want to get off to a start on the subject that you've written and spoken a good deal about recently, and that is the remarkable moment in which we live when the world is truly awash in change. And we see that, I think, in many ways. We see it in Ukraine and Mr. Putin's aggression against Ukraine. We see it in the Middle East with the surge of ISIS and other radical jihadists. We see it in Nigeria, where Boko Haram is rampaging without any serious opposition from either the national government or the international community. Of these and the other crises that we confront today, what is, in your view, the characteristic of the nature of the change that we are experiencing in our times? What links these different crises and the response that the international community and the United States of America should make?
Well, I think we have to understand the fundamental challenge to the state system of governing. We think of the way the world works as there are states that have borders that are respected and they interact somehow or other, and that's the way things get managed. The assault on borders by Russia, and in the case of ISIS and affiliated and like-minded type organizations, they reject the idea of countries. They want to produce a caliphate that rules, that cuts across states. They don't exist in their view. So we're in a battle of how to preserve a system that works and provides us the basis for government. And terrorism, which we focus on, is their tactic. In a sense, think of terrorism as the tactic, and the strategy is to destroy the state system and substitute something else. In the case of Russia, they want a sphere of influence world. They're not quite the same thing as the Islamist one, but nevertheless, it comes down to the same thing as breaking down the state as the unit of governance.
What has created this historic moment, which makes this a time when different groups, even a strong state itself like Russia, attack the state system.
Russia, in my opinion, is sort of a country grieving for its past. The old Soviet Union held a lot of territory that Russia doesn't now hold. It has a history of empire. But if you look at it carefully, Mr. Putin is playing a very weak hand. Demographically, fertility in Russia is very low. The longevity of men is only about 64. Something like 25% of men die before they're 55 years old. He has practically an open rebellion in the Caucasus, and he has his own Islamic problem there. He has a long border with China, a lot of resources on one side and hardly anybody, and a lot of people on the other side. However much they may interact, that's a problem. So, and then he has a country that has depended almost totally on oil and gas revenues as the basis for their budget. Now, of course, prices have been cut in half. And furthermore, as people react to what he's doing, and at least it seems to me as we should be trying to get people to react, we should be getting up an energy program designed to see to it that the countries around Russia are not, they don't, he doesn't have a monopoly of oil and gas sales to them. So we want to break that monopoly. It ought to be possible to do it. Oil is very plentiful, and we need to develop our LNG capacity. In Lithuania port, there is a LNG receiving ship right now, and I think they're getting LNG from Norway. But we should be ramping all that up. And I might say that these losses will be losses of market share that will be permanent, because he has demonstrated that he is not a reliable supplier, that he will turn it on and off depending on his circumstances. So I think we should be doing that, and we should be paying more attention to our own armed forces. And I'm here in Washington, and here you think the way to manage a budget is to have everybody do everything they can by a percentage basis. You sequester. You cut everything by X percent. It's the most insane thing I ever heard of. Only in Washington does something like that take place. It's ridiculous. The sooner you get rid of that, the better. And then I think our appropriations for military are too low. Probably I don't put myself forward as a military expert. But I think there's a lot of work to be done to beef ourselves up, and with some leadership from us, beef up NATO so that we can reassure the NATO countries that they're not going to be overwhelmed by Russia.
Do you think sanctions can convince Mr. Putin that he is playing the weak hand and he should back off?
Well, sanctions are part of it. Our energy program that I mentioned is another part of it. Beefing up our military capabilities is another part of it, and showing, of course, you have to show a willingness to respond. I always remember the day at the start of World War II when I was in Marine Corps boot camp. The sergeant hands me my rifle, and he says, "Take good care of this rifle. This is your best friend. And remember one thing. Never point this rifle at anybody unless you're willing to pull the trigger. No empty threats." So we need to observe that. No empty threats. When you draw a line, a bright red line somewhere, and it gets crossed and you don't do anything, people don't pay any attention anymore. So I think we have to show that if we say something is going to happen, it happens.
And should that include military aid to Ukraine?
Absolutely. I think Ukraine has a lot of corruption problems, and so we want to try to help with that and help with their economy, but we also have to be willing to help train and equip the Ukrainian military. We don't even need to think about boots on the ground. There are plenty of Ukrainian boots on the ground, but they need to be equipped better and they need to be trained better. Because they're Russian, I mean, what's being, they're described as rebels are Russian troops, Russian equipment.
Do you think that Putin will realize that he is playing a weak hand and back off, or do you see that actually making him be even harder?
I think that if we are determined and clearly strong, that will register. But I also think that we ought to have an off-ramp there, maintain a dialogue, and be ready to talk at any moment, and try to get things back into a posture where we have a more sensible kind of relationship, as we did for quite a long while. A wounded bear with all those nuclear weapons is not a healthy thing.
And what is your sense of the ability of the American leadership today to maintain a united position with the Europeans as this crisis deepens?
Are having their trouble, but the most important country in many ways is Germany. And Angela Merkel is turning out to be the toughest minded of all. So that's a plus. And I think with some leadership we can get somewhere. France, after all, it canceled delivery on some cruisers that they had scheduled to send to Russia, although Hollande has made some weak statements recently. But Angela Merkel seems to be very strong, determined, and sees the threat represented by being oblivious to borders and what they're supposed to mean.
This wave of change that is also sweeping over the Middle East, how do you define the nature of the problem that American foreign policy faces today in the Arab countries and in the Middle East at large?
Well, we obviously face the tactic of terrorism that can take place on a scale. As I said earlier, I think we also face a movement that sees a world not governed by the state system, but governed by some, whatever caliphate means, it means some sort of loose Islamic type governing process. So we face that. We also face the fact that it seems particularly so in the Middle East, that people don't really know or haven't thought much about how you govern over diversity. Take Iraq. Iraq had diversity. It had Shiites, it had Sunnis, it had Kurds. And Mr. Maliki, as president of Iraq, acted as though the Sunnis and the Kurds didn't exist. So he brought the thing to ruin. You have to say to yourself, if you have diversity, you have to pay attention to it. After all, you're in the information and communication age, and everybody knows what's going on, and everybody can organize, and they can do something, so you have to pay attention. It's interesting that our founding fathers, remember George, there's a wonderful painting in the Metropolitan Museum. It shows George Washington crossing the Delaware. There he is with his vision and his sword. And there's a Lieutenant Monroe who's holding a flag. And there are 11 other people in this boat representing 13 colonies. And they're all different. So you might say that was an exhibition of George Washington governing over diversity and using the revolutionary impetus as the uniting factor. So he recognized the diversity, but he had a uniting factor. Now, when he was leading that army, he had a terrible time with the national government because the government of the time wouldn't appropriate any money to pay his troops, so he had a terrible time, and he wanted to have something reasonably strong as a federal government in a new constitution. But people were so shy of having too much power concentrated anywhere that they created a three-part government. Checked and balances. They didn't want anybody to be too strong. And in the Senate, as distinct from the House, every state had two senators. Can you imagine these Virginians, Washington, Madison, Jefferson, very populous state, agreeing that Rhode Island would have the same number of votes as they had? that's a recognition of diversity, that you've got to have a system where the big can't roll over the small. And then there are constitutions. Everything that means a lot to your daily life was left to the states and localities and individuals. It was an entrepreneurial society made of a lot of farmers. And what that means is that they recognize different states were in a different conditions, different economies, different attitudes, and they could express themselves. So they were governing over diversity in a very intelligent way. And it worked. But in the Middle East now, I don't think they have much of a clue. I worry, for example, about Israel, which I'm very fond of. But Israel has a big Palestinian population. And they're now going back about the process of governance. As far as I can see, it's consistent only with the idea of a so-called one-state solution. And if you have a one-state solution, then you're going to have more Arabs than you have Jews. And how are you going to govern? You're going to have to govern over diversity and recognize it. Can't ignore it. You can't say one is better than the other. You've got to treat people the same. And there's a lot of adjusting to do. So I think that's a general problem of governance that everybody faces. We face it in this country. Whenever the federal government does something, it's very homogenizing. But there are a lot of parts of the country that don't want to be homogenized. Remember, the president of Turkey went to Istanbul, and there was an ancient place, and he wanted to destroy it and build a building there. Remember, there was a big revolt. Let the president come to San Francisco and want to wipe out Chinatown and see where he gets. No way that's going to happen. I'm not suggesting he's even thinking about that, but nobody would think about that. That's the point, that we are able to express our diversity. So that's a big thing.
What do you think our chances are that this jihadist ISIS movement will burn itself out simply because it is so draconian, so barbaric, that the people there will come to rebel against it? Can we count on that, or do we need to do other things?
Well, I think we want to encourage people in the Muslim world, the Arab world, to speak out, as the president of Egypt recently did. And that's a good trend. But I think it won't just sort of peter out. We have to push against it. Let me give an example of something that's going on in San Francisco that I like. We have a guy there named Bill Swing. He's a retired Episcopal bishop of California. And he started something called the United Religion Initiatives. And he found, when he went around to the heads of the different religions, they're all stovepiped. So he goes around and he appeals to sort of rank-and-file people in religions and gets them together. He's got millions of people involved by now. He's got something like 700, calls them cooperation circles. He gets people from various religions together, and they talk about subjects where they can see a common problem and try to do something about it, like education or economic development or nuclear weapons or whatever. These are the subjects they get together and talk about. And so they learn that, yes, you are one religion and I'm another religion, but yet these are topics that affect us both, and we can get somewhere and we can make a better life for ourselves, and I can go away respecting your right to have your religion, you respect my right to have my religion. The most prominent religious groups are Christians and Muslims, and then followed by Hindus and Jews. But there's something like 16 different religions he has listed in his thing. So I think that's the kind of thing that is helpful. It's all volunteer. Private money, I might say. I don't know that he'd even want to take government money. So it's not like a government program.
I want to come back to the idea that you advanced about the spheres of influence, but first I wanted to also come back to the home front a little bit. You first came to Washington in the Eisenhower years, I believe. When you look back...
Yeah, he was a general who became president for some of you younger people.
What's the best advice you ever got in Washington, and what would you pass on to perhaps young people who are starting in Washington now?
Well, when I was named Secretary of Labor, I was told that President Eisenhower would see me if I wanted an appointment. Having served in his administration and been an admirer, naturally, everybody liked Ike. I went to see him. He was in Walter Reed Hospital. He died 4 or 5 months later. So again, here's this genial man lying in bed. We start talking about the Department of Labor. And I was astonished at how much he knew about it. Really, detailed stuff. Then we start talking about golf and different courses we both played and holes and the characteristics. We were having a good time. And about a half an hour or so had gone by, and a doctor comes in and says, enough time, go away. And all of a sudden, this genial man got very stern. He was fingering my face like this. He says, young man, you're going to come down here, and you're going to work 12 hours a day, 7 days a week, and you're going to think you're doing your job. Let me tell you something. If that's what you do, there's no way you can do your job. You just burn yourself out. He said, I can see you like golf as much as I do. If you don't get out on some golf course at least twice a week, get your mind on something else. You won't be able to do your job. He said, don't worry about the press. They'll get on you for it. They don't have a clue about what it takes to do these jobs.
Even then.
But it was good advice. And sort of step back from the immediate milieu that you're always in and get a little perspective. I used a version of that. I did try to get out and play tennis or golf or something on weekends, but I used a version of that fairly regularly. I would take some time during the day when I'm, not the end of the day when you're tired out, earlier in the day when you're fresher, and set aside, say, 3/4 of an hour, and tell, no calls unless my wife calls or the president calls.
I like the order.
And then I go sit myself down in a comfortable chair with a pad and pencil, take a deep breath and say, what are we trying to do around here? What are our broad objectives? In other words, get myself out of the tactical milieu that you're constantly in and try to think more broadly about what our objectives are, what our strategy ought to be, and put everything in perspective. So that was part of what I got from Mr. Eisenhower.
Let me ask you to apply that broad vision question to a subject that is roiling our politics to a great extent today, and that is immigration. What is the fresh start we need on immigration, if we need one?
Well, first we need to understand the problem, which we obviously don't, at least as I read about what passes for the conversation in Washington. People think the problem is to construct a fence along our border with Mexico. And I hear people yelling about that all the time. That's not the problem. In Mexico today, fertility is a little below replacement level. The Mexican economy will be picking up. Their labor costs are comparable with China's. Their energy costs are less. Their transportation costs to this part of the world are much less. So their economy will start picking up. Their labor force is not increasing. When all these babies or young people showed up on our border a few months ago, there were no Mexicans there. Our problem is not our border with Mexico. Our problem is Mexico's southern border. And deeper than that, it's what is it about conditions in Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador that create conditions so severe that parents want to send their children north? It's pretty bad. It's murderous. A lot of it is part of the drug issues. But shouldn't we, so it seems to me, if we look at our border problem, we should be saying to ourselves, what's going on in those countries, and is there something we can do to help them out? And then we can try to help Mexico in their southern border. That's going to do more for our border with Mexico than anything else. We should try to make our border with Mexico like our border with Canada. You know, the Mexican-U.S. border is the most cross-border in the world legally today. And I might say our trade with Canada and Mexico, Canada's our biggest partner, Mexico's third biggest, we're their biggest trading partners. And our imports from Canada are 25% U.S. content. Our imports from Mexico are 40% U.S. content. So North America has arrived. And we do realize that and conduct ourselves in such a way that we don't act as though we can't do a thing until we get the Mexican border sealed and whatever. And there's so much thing. We need more H-1B visas. We need a guest worker program. We need more people to have the green cards that allow them to go back and forth if they want to. There are 1 million Canadians living in California today. Fine, there's no problem.
How do we change the political debate so that we can focus on the economic factors in particular that you've just brought up?
That you live here, you tell me. I find it impossible to believe that you go to a hearing in the Armed Services Committee and you have to defend yourself against assault. What is going on in this town? This is where you live.
Maybe we'll get some pointers from the audience when we come to the Q&A. But you just demonstrated why you are not only the holder of the Medal of Freedom, but also you've been awarded the American Whig Cleosophic Economic Medal as well, which must be one of your proudest positions. I ran across this in reading about you.
At Princeton deal.
Princeton, all right. But usually,
I might say Princeton has an aura. It was so when I was there, which was a long time ago, class of 42, Princeton's greatest class. But there was always the aura of Princeton and the nation's service. And you always got this. Serving in the government is a very honorable, important thing to do. So when I started out, I wanted to study economics. And I always thought, if I had a chance to serve in government, I'd like to do it. So as an economist, I was invited to serve as what was called a senior staff economist on the President Eisenhower's Council of Economic Advisors. So I went. It was a great year. I learned a lot, contributed what I could. But public service is something that came out of the ethos of Princeton.
Use your background as an economist and tell us what the collapse in oil prices, explain the context of that for national security policy by the U.S.
Well, of course, what it does is we have had this surge of oil and gas discoveries here. Been a very positive thing. And I might say, having been Secretary of the Treasury when we had the first Arab oil boycott, I think of security a lot. And I think that oil up in Canada does not go through the Strait of Hormuz. To me, it's a no-brainer. Come on, get real. Let's get that oil down here. And then it's secure. So we have good supplies of energy now, and that's a good thing, but it's much broader than that. Some of the people who are adversaries, like Russia, like Venezuela, like Iran, the price of oil is half of what it was. That has a big impact on their budgets, so I'm not weeping about that. But I think that we have something beyond the oil and gas to think about when it comes to energy. I see Gary Ruffhead is sitting here. He has pioneered at Hoover and I think with Brookings a major effort to study the Arctic. What's going on in the Arctic? A lot. A new ocean is being created. This is the first time since the last ice age that anything like that happened. And there are major melts taking out elsewhere around the world. So the climate is warming. The physical evidence is there for you to see. And I think it's fairly apparent to me anyway that we have something to do with that. So what should we be doing? I think there are two things we should be doing. reasonably aggressively. Number one, we want to encourage sustained, substantial support for energy R&D. The amount of federal dollars involved, you can't even find in the rounding error of the budget, but it's substantial in this field. And it's interesting to me, I chair the MIT Energy Initiative Advisory Panel, and the same with Stanford, so I hear what these guys are saying. And they're really getting somewhere. And as an example, we had a scientist earlier, a couple of weeks ago, at our roundtable at Hoover, who I think has, I say I think because it isn't absolutely in the bin yet, but he is going to tell us how to create large-scale storage of electricity. That is a breakthrough. It takes the intermittency problem out of wind and solar. And mark me, our energy system is really vulnerable. Our grid is vulnerable to cyber attack, let alone natural disasters. And anybody with any sense has some energy where you use it. So large-scale storage capability is a huge potential to make us more secure. So I would be supporting energy R&D. And as I said, the amount of money at MIT and Stanford anyway, two that I know something about, it's about 3-to-1 private money over government money. Because what happens when private enterprise, private energy consuming and using companies see something serious, they want to know what's going on, and they come and they give money. And from our standpoint, at Stanford, we're not nervous about companies being around. We figure, what the hell, Silicon Valley is just a big Stanford spinoff. We know these guys. And,
true that.
But they're, after all, they're the people that can commercialize and scale something, so you want them there. They know how to do it. So we want that to happen. The other thing we need to have happen, I think, is a substantial revenue-neutral carbon tax. People want to call it a fee, fine, but it's a tax. Personally, I like to call it what it is. It's a tax. And make it revenue neutral so there's no fiscal drag, so the money that's generated can't be used for some other purpose. It's just for the purpose of putting a price on carbon. And I would substitute that for this rash of regulatory things. The government is telling you, do this, don't do that, and so on. You can't even figure out what the regulatory maze amounts to. It creates a lot of uncertainty. If you just put a price out there, let people respond to the price, and they'll think of all kinds of things, and you'll get carbon down. So if we did those two things, and people say, well, what about China? Well, yeah, China's a big issue, but if we put a tax on, and then we can put a border tax on, to tax any imports, that they need to have been treated similarly. But I think there would be a lot of emulation. I had the experience during the Reagan years of a lot of scientists thought the ozone layer was depleting, but there were other people who doubted. They all agreed that if it happened, it would be a catastrophe. These days, when something like that is there, you vilify the people who are opposed or doubters, and you try to destroy them. That's the way politics in Washington wire. But back in the Reagan days, we did the opposite. We put our arms around the doubters, and we said, okay, you have your opinion, but let's take out an insurance policy. You agree that it would be a catastrophe. Insurance is a concept that appeals to people. You say, there's a risk. I hope it doesn't materialize. You don't want your house to burn down, but you take out fire insurance. You hope it doesn't materialize. If it does, you've done something about it. So in this case, when the thing, something is clear, the entrepreneurial juices in the American economy are really impressive. And in this case, the DuPont company came up with something that you could do. not something that you say by 2050 I will do something or other. Something I can do today, I can put into effect. And so we got people to do that. And the result was something called the Montreal Protocol. It really worked. And in retrospect now, everybody agrees that the scientists who were worried were right, and the Montreal Protocol came along just in time. So I say, why don't we use the insurance principle and support R&D? And things like the large-scale storage, leaving aside the climate business, that helps our security. And let's have a tax on carbon. And the market works. The market really works. And that's my insurance policy.
George, I want to come back to this challenging idea of yours of the effort by Russia, and I would guess China as well, to establish spheres of influence. The Cold War, in many ways, was based on spheres of influence. Is this something that is inimical to American interest abroad? Is it something we can accept? And just to use one small example that's crept into the news in the last week or two, it would be a sphere of influence argument to say the United States should no longer pursue the overthrow of Bashar al-Assad in Syria, that he's there, and as long as he maintains a peaceful frontier with Israel, we shouldn't seek his overthrow. What's your own view on that?
Well, in the case of Assad, he is a cruel dictator. And how anybody thinks he can rule over people to whom he has subjected what he's done is beyond me. It started out with people who were genuinely worried, and they were part of the Arab Spring, part of the emergence of the information and communication age and what it means in governance. It means that people who have been ignored can express themselves, and they started to do so. And I thought at the time that we should have done more than we did. We've done really very little. For instance, he still has his air, and he still uses the air to bomb his people. I can't believe that we don't have the capability of eliminating that air. I know there are air defenses and they're mobile, but Israel seems to be able to handle it. If they can handle it, it seems to me we ought to be able to handle it. And having done that, we can make his airfields unusable. And we can take away some of these very cruel bombing things that he does. So I don't have much sympathy for Assad.
I suspected that might be the case. I'm delighted to hear your answer. We'll turn to the audience now. If you could state your name and affiliation, and perhaps defend the Washington reputation better than I've been able to do. Sir.
D. Smith, Strategic Insight Group, and Dallas Committee on Foreign Relations. So I'm from Texas. I'm afraid I can't defend the Washington side very much. But thank you very much for your observations. And going back to your first comments, I was wondering what your thoughts are on the extent to which it's the pulling back of the U.S. that has loosened the reins, so to speak, and is behind the what we seem to be seeing, the failure of the Westphalian state system, whatever you want to call it, and what we can do about that just in the context of the fact that we don't have the resources or the political will to be the policeman of the world. So is it an inevitable consequence of America pulling back that we're going to have this more chaotic world that threatens the state system?
I think when America withdraws, and that's the watchword for what the U.S. attitude toward ourselves is, it's really devastating. But think back a little bit. At the end of World War II, we had some gifted people in the Truman administration. They were located in the State Department mostly, who looked back, and what did they see? They saw two world wars. They saw the first one was settled in rather vindictive terms that helped lead to the second. They saw 61 million people were killed in the Second World War, let alone injured, displaced. They saw the Holocaust. They saw the Great Depression. They saw the protectionism and currency manipulation that aggravated it. And they said to themselves, what a crummy world. And we are part of it, whether we like it or not. So they set out to do something about it. And as they were getting along, the Cold War emerged. So the doctrine of containment developed. NATO was created. The Bretton Woods system was created. The Marshall Plan was created. And we turned to Japan and Germany, our adversaries, and instead of a vindictive settlement, they were encouraged to become more democratic countries with strong economies and be part of the solution and not part of the problem. So it was a brilliant period, and it carried on almost on a nonpartisan basis until the end of the Cold War. It was American leadership, without a doubt. It wasn't America policemen running the world. It was America coming with ideas and resources and ready to solve problems. The Marshall Plan, it's interesting to you think back on the Marshall Plan. Marshall Plan wasn't a U.S. aid program. In the Marshall Plan, people said to the European countries, figure out what a sensible economic policy is as you see it for your country. And then we'll talk about it, and if it seems sensible to us and you need some support, it's here. That's the Marshall Plan. In other words, we didn't impose some U.S. idea on everybody. We let them develop some ideas and interacted with them and developed it and so on. So it's a myth to think that all this period was the U.S. being the policeman of the world. But we were the leader. And leadership means that you're willing to identify problems, you're willing to point up solutions and alternatives, and you're willing to work with people on them and try to get somewhere. And I think when we're not there, there is no other leader. Europe is in disarray. Russia and China are otherwise inclined. There's no one to give some leadership if the United States doesn't do it. But it's a mistake always to say, well, the U.S. can't be the policeman of the world. That's not what we're talking about. That's not what would happen throughout the whole post-World War II period. We led. I can remember once when I was Secretary of Treasury, the international economic scene was in disarray. The exchange rate system was wild. And we developed a plan. It's funny, I worked all summer long to develop this plan. I took it to the President. I had the World Bank IMF meetings coming up. I said, Mr. President, here's your speech. He was to speak. He looked at it, he said, no, this is your speech. So he spoke and he said, and tomorrow my Secretary of the Treasury is going to unveil the U.S. plan. What a hype. But anyway, I invited the finance ministers of France, Germany, UK, and Japan to come on the Sunday ahead of time. I showed them the speech, invited them to make comments. They all made a few comments. Nobody touched the conceptual structure of the speech, but they had little words of nuance that they thought would be helpful. Anyway, I gave my speech, and we continued to work on this problem. And our plan was not adopted, but we got to a system of some kind that people agreed on. So the situation was settled down. So the U.S. took a lead, and nothing was happening until the U.S. took a lead. But it wasn't like we were pushing our ideas down everybody's throat. It was more that you have some leadership and you get people following along and making constructive suggestions, and something constructive comes out of that. That's what we need to be doing.
That's interesting. I was talking recently to Valerie Giscard d'Estaing about that very period, and he told very much the same story you did, except, as Giscard tells it, it was his idea. But anyway,
Well, it was an interesting thing that Henry Kissinger watched this process, and he liked it. He was impressed. And after I left office, he was Secretary of State by that time, I get a call saying that we've heard from these people you used to deal with. They're all heads of government by that time. And they want to have a heads of government thing like you had when you were Secretary of the Treasury. And we don't know what they really have in mind. Would you go around and feel them out? So I did. I flew from San Francisco to Bonn. Helmut Schmidt had become a real good friend. And we sat and talked. And by 3 o'clock in the morning, I said, Helmut, I've had it. I've got to go to bed. But anyway, we had a good discussion of it. Then I went to Britain. Then I came back to Paris. We're sitting in the Elysee Palace with Giscard and myself, and the phone rings, it's Helmut. And Helmut says, why don't I come over and the three of us have dinner tonight? So Giscard agreed. So I go to a friend of mine who had an apartment in Paris because I thought all the phones were bugged if I went to my hotel room. And I called in and said, I have this meeting tonight. I can turn it on, I can turn it off, or I can leave it in neutral. I think this is a very good idea, and people are on the level. That's my opinion. But I'll sit by this telephone, and you call me back and tell me what you want to do. So a couple of hours later, the phone rings. It says, President says, go ahead. So we turned it on. And so there were 5, and then the Europeans said, we've got to have Italy. And so we said, we've got to have Canada, and that's how the G7 was born. But it's been a good thing.
Right here.
My name is Scott Cooper. I'm actually a Marine as well. I retired last year from the Marine Corps, though far less renowned, and I work as the National Security Director at Human Rights First now.
Semper Fi.
Well, sir. I wonder if I could turn your eye toward China for a moment. You know, some 6 years ago, we had this pivot to the Pacific, as it was called, which critics would say that was unnecessarily creating an enemy out of China. And yet at the same time, you recognize that there is an opportunity to move in a different direction with them, and yet we also see some irresponsible behavior, be it in the cyber world, be it in the South China Sea, and as one who flew jets in the Marine Corps, I know that it just takes one irresponsible action of a jet pilot to screw things up. I wonder if you could talk about where you see this relationship going and what our policy should be toward the great nation of China.
I never liked the idea of pivoting toward anything because it seems to me that the United States has to conduct a global diplomacy, and we can do it. So you have to pay attention to places, and if you say you're going to just pay attention here, then everything else goes to hell and they wonder why you're forgetting about them. Actually, since we said we were paying attention to the Pacific, the Middle East has grown on fire, the Russian thing has, and that's what we're paying attention to. So conduct a global diplomacy and move your chips around as you need to. As far as China's concerned, as I see it, China has some very considerable problems. Beginning about 30 years ago, fertility dropped like a stone. So for a quarter of a century, China has had a rising labor force and a shrinking number of people the labor force had to support. And they also had a large movement from rural areas to urban areas, which is a source of productivity gain. So they had this period of a rising labor force and a rising productivity of the labor force. Your rate of increase in GDP is the sum of those two things. So they had these huge increases in their GDP. Now it's almost like throwing a switch. These low fertility years are starting to be the labor force. So the labor force rate of increase is starting to decline. In the meantime, the big labor force is starting to retire. They're older. And the Chinese, if you look at Chinese history, I believe I'm correct in saying that the historic pattern in China is that in effect, their safety net was the family and the community. But these people have moved out of that environment into urban areas. They're much more anonymous. So I can't see how China's big increases in rate of increase in GDP can continue, given these labor force characteristics. And at the same time, they have a huge problem of dealing with people now in these urban areas who are retired. They're very well aware of the problem. It's not like they're, saying something they don't realize, but it's perfectly obvious that there's certain things about what's going on that are, they're just there, and that's a reality. So I think that is a moment of truth for them in a sense. And it seems to me they will come to realize that. And if we stand with people in the areas, what they have created is a lot of resentment in the Philippines and Vietnam and so on and so on and so on. We didn't have to do that. That just happens when they you start pushing people around. So they probably will want to draw back a little bit, at least I would hope so. And something like the Japanese island problem, it's a ridiculous problem. It was sitting there, nobody paying any attention, and the Japanese bought the island. That was very provocative. And what we need to do is somehow put it back to sleep. There's no way to settle it. So just put it to sleep. A problem that is there, and you realize it, and you don't pay any attention to it. That's the way to handle that. But I think it's important to have a good, strong interaction with China. I know when I took office, our relations were on the rocky side. I remember going to Beijing, meeting with Deng Xiaoping and my counterpart, Wu Jiqian, and we said, okay, you put on the table everything you want to put on the table. I'll put on the table everything I want to put on the table. And then let's make an agenda out of that. And then I'll agree to come to China at least once a year. You agree to come to the U.S. at least once a year. And there are probably three or four times when we meet in the same place in international meetings. Let's agree to set aside, say, 3 hours just to us to talk about, go through this agenda and work our way through the agenda. And it worked out fine, and we had a very smooth period. And I should think something like that could work again.
Hi, Mr. Secretary. Welcome to Washington again. Al Felsenberg.
Actually, I think Washington is a great city, and I'm just kidding. But it was extraordinary, that hearing.
Well, welcome back. Al Felsenberg, Joint Economic Committee of the United States Congress. The other news yesterday that came out of Washington, other than your appearance, was our Cuba relations. Many of us grew up in the shadow of the Cuban Missile Crisis and its aftermath. The president tells us our policy hasn't been working. Okay, we can discuss this. But yesterday, the Castro brothers are making it very, very hard for anybody, even maybe this administration, to say yes. A week ago, they preconditioned our recognition of them on our going easier on our human rights requests. And now they want us to get out of Gitmo and many, many other things. I guess they realize this is more important to the current administration than it might be to the Cubans. So my question is, what kind of a policy toward Cuba, and for that matter, toward the rest of this hemisphere looking southward, would you recommend to the next president who takes office in 2017?
Well, first of all, during the Cold War, Cuba was a Soviet base. They flew espionage missions from there. It wasn't just the missile crisis. It was a base. So naturally, they were an adversary. The Cold War is over. So it has seemed to me, why do we want to have an adversarial relationship? We don't take that attitude toward China, toward the Soviet Union, toward a lot of countries that we don't think are doing things right. We have an agenda with them. We try to work back and forth. The Cuban as people are very capable people. Look what they've done when they come to the United States. So I've long favored changing our relationship with Cuba. When we do it and we have a bargaining session, I'd like to think that we did a good job of bargaining. Doesn't look to me like we did a good job. We left a lot of stuff on the table that could have been done if we had a skillful guy like Haley Barber doing the bargaining for us. It would have come out different. But here we are. And I think let time pass, let relationships develop, and we'll see where we go. We've got to keep having an agenda. We have an agenda on human rights with Cuba. We should maintain it. And various other things we can do. But I don't see anything wrong with having a reasonable relationship with Cuba. So I know everybody is sounding off about how terrible it is to be trying to recognize Cuba. Personally, I don't share that view.
George, I want to thank you for this brilliant tour d'horizon, as they say in another language.
Yes, you are.
And to say you'll be welcome back here anytime. So please come on back.
Hoover has recently established this physical place here as a place for us to come. And we're a Stanford-based organization. We're on the West Coast. We like it there. And I think it probably helps us not to be here all the time because you tend to think more strategically if you're not embedded in the Washington, all the stuff that goes on. On the other hand, we thought we should have an outpost here, a place that's a nice place with some good people around. So they've established this arrangement, and it looks like a nice place to me, and we have a few people like Paige around who we know is doing a great job. And so I'm glad to be here. Thank you, Jim.
And thank you.